What's going on, guys? Got Theater Dimensions by Zandria here for you, so let's get right into this. All right, so Where the Heart is Home very much gave me a feeling of kind of preparing for war, you know, like troops marching over the mountains through the fog, you know, as the dawn breaks and all that kind of stuff. Super cool. Gave me a little bit of a Pirates of the Caribbean feel as well in that intro there. But very, very nice, strong intro. Very adventurous, you know, setting up for, you know, the rest of the song and the rest of the album. When the voices came in, amazing. Just sounded great. They let you know they were there, and then they just, like, right came at you. It was really, really awesome. The guitar sounded great. Vocals sounded great. Just really, really, really strong opening song. Enjoyed it a lot. Love the chorus. The little transition that had the piano and the guitar in it, I just put piano plus guitar transition equals yes. So a really, really great, just awesome, awesome, awesome opening track. Definitely, definitely strapped you in for the ride and started the ride. Really, really great. Death to the Holy, drums, exclamation point. Yeah, awesome. All right, cool. And the vocals, along with the rhythm of the music, really played well off each other. They really kind of intertwined it, but also it was just really the timing of the vocal lines along with the rhythm of the instruments was just really, really awesome. I love that, having kind of like moving my head while I was sitting here with my headphones on. Awesome, awesome. Choir sounds really good in this one. I love the way the choir voices and Diane's voices just really complement and play off each other extremely well. Like, none overpowers the other, and they just sound really, really great together. And of course, by themselves as well, but when they really come together, it's really, really awesome. Especially on this track in particular. And there are a couple other tracks, but I'll talk about that later. All right. And then there was a point in the song where it kind of went genty a little bit, you know, because it was kind of going along, then just kind of went like gent and everything. I was like, oh, wow, cool, awesome. I really like the narration, you know, the talking, and it really, really nice when they like put that in there. That was really, really cool. Nice touch. Gave the song like a little extra dimension. All right, cool, but very nice. And then the ending was really, really interesting. Like, the mood change and then the ending was very, very nice. I like how they did that as well. Awesome. Now, 3, Forsaken Love. A little folky touch in there. You know, I like that. You know, kind of pulled back a little bit and kind of gave it a little bit of a little folk sound there. A little kind of calming. Very, very emotional. Like, there's like a lot of emotion, you know, going into this album, but like this was the first song where I was like, wow, this is really like, you know, emotional and kind of hits you in the feels, you know what I mean? Just, wow. Yeah. And I really like in this one how the guitars and everything, when they all came in, they didn't overpower the vocals. Because every time they were doing like their thing, you know, because the guitars are really, really heavy, you know, kind of crisp and crunchy. And they were almost right. The part was like, oh, it's about to overtake the vocals. It's about to overtake the vocals. But it never did. So, like, that was really good. The control there of, like, you know, the dynamics of the instruments. And, like, as a compliment and also kind of a contrast to the vocals there was really nice. I was like, oh, it's going to be too overpowering right here. Oh, right here. But it never happened. And I was like, oh, cool. Awesome. So, very nice being aware of like the dynamics of the instruments and the dynamics of the voice there. Never overpowered the voice and, you know, kept the mood of the song, you know, a little more calm. Even though there was like, you know, kind of heaviness, gentiness going on under it. But awesome. Awesome though. Call of Destiny. I'll put my review for that in the description, but just kind of wakes you up from Forsaken Love, you know, it's like, and I was like, oh, okay, cool, yeah, awesome. You know, it's just like, okay, here we go. Just like really, really cool song. like the first, you know, feel good song of the album, I'd say. You know, the one that's like mostly positive throughout, you know. But really, really excellent. Really excellent song. That one was actually well placed to be right after Forsaken Love, because it kind of wakes you up and it's like, okay. Bam, 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 bam. Awesome. And so after that, and if you remember in my review of Call of Destiny, I wondered if Call of Destiny was going to come before or after We Are Murderers. And so it came right after Forsaken Love, and then We Are Murderers came right after Call of Destiny, which I found very interesting, which I'll also get more into when I talk about Dark Knight of the Soul. So you have first three tracks are, you know, really intro-y, adventurous, you know, and kind of the next two are, you know, have narration and are kind of soft. Then you have Call of Destiny, which is kind of, you know, the wake-up track, and it's like super, you know, happy and motivative and everything, especially the chorus, you know. And then you have We Are Murderers, We All, which is just dark and doomy and gloomy and heavy, and it even has harsh vocals, and it's just kind of like, oh, Call of Destiny was so happy, though. What happened? Then you just get, like, destroyed by We Are Murderers, We All. It's super, super dark, evil, scary, you know, psychologically, you know, thought-provoking. And it just kind of, like, knocks all the first four tracks, you know, like, out of the window. It's like, oh, happiness, blah, evil death, ha, ha, ha. We all kill people, blah, blah, blah. You know, just totally just destroys any happiness you had right there, which was awesome. Like, and I'll put my full review of this in the description as well, but like, awesome. Just totally offsets the entire mood of the first four tracks and just totally just like destroys your faith in humanity for a while, which I enjoy, you know. Definitely very thought-provoking track, you know, the first really, really kind of cerebral track there, which I really enjoy. You know, it's dark and just really, really makes you think, you know, like, you know, even throws in religion there. And if you watch the lyric video, it's like pollution and like starving people, and it's just really, really, really thought-provoking, really dark and like meaningful still. You know, it's not just like, oh, rage, anger, kill, blah, blah, blah. It's like, oh, we do this, and then we think it's okay because we go to confession, and, oh, you know, we turned into sheep, and we do what we want to, and ignore all the bad things that come from it, you know? We're killing the planet, we're drowning it in blood, and all this stuff. So, excellent, excellent tracks for the first, you know, bit of the album right there. And so, then we go from Dark Knight of the Soul, which didn't start out as I thought it did. I thought it'd be more of, like, We Are Murderers, We All, you know, dark, heavy, and just kind of, you know, like, doom, 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 doom. But it wasn't that. It was, very flowing, you know? That was interesting, and, like, I didn't expect it to flow the way it did, but it flowed very, very smoothly. It kind of, put it out. It was kind of like a river, really, you know what I mean? And it wasn't, you know, extremely intense, wasn't super dark. Bass, you know, thumbs up on that. Awesome. And it was a very nice follow-up to We Are Murderers, We All, and I actually thought if this would have been the final track, it would have worked very well as a final track, because it just had that feeling of, you know, finality to it. And it just had, it was kind of like a come down from the first five tracks, and just followed all of those tracks really well, especially We Are Murderers and Call of Destiny. And like, I felt like if that would have been the final track, it would have been an excellent, like, you know, track to wrap everything up on. But still, still very, very nice. This track probably had one of the best, singing, you know, parts from Diane. I really love how the voice sounded in this one. But very, very, very nice how all these tracks, you know, so far, you know, like, complemented and kind of piggybacked and also contrasted one another at points. I really like how they did that. Okay, When the Walls Came Down, Heartache Was Born. Intro. Awesome. Okay, so I didn't write down too much for this track. I wrote down intro, drums, awesome, Creepy, and Attack on Titan. And so, because this song, like, literally when I was hearing it, I was just kind of thinking of Attack on Titan. And if none of y'all know what that is, it's this anime where these people live in a world where there are these huge giant creatures called Titans that come in and just pretty much, like, eat people and kill people. And the first episode starts off with people in this walled city, and they've been living there for years. They've been safe because no Titans, you know, are big enough to come over this wall or break through this wall. And then suddenly one day there's a Titan who's taller than this wall, breaks this wall, comes in, destroys the village. You know, like, one of the main characters sees his mom get killed by one. And I was pretty much just thinking of that the whole time. Like, it just reminded me of Attack on Titan for the whole time I was listening to it. So I didn't write down too much, because as the song was going, I was just thinking of, like, all the episodes of Attack on Titan I had seen. So pretty much this was just really, it was kind of like, you know, very much a story, like, in and of itself. But I'm not sure if that's just because the way I thought about it, but a very, very nice song. It has, like, kind of a creepy element to it, you know, not, like, scary, but just kind of, you know, kind of a little ominous to it, but very, very interesting, though. I really didn't expect, I didn't expect my thought process to go that way for the song. I didn't even expect this song to sound like it did, but very, very, very nice song. I really enjoyed this one. All right, Ship of Doom. All right, this one actually made me smile here. Okay, so the opening with the voices was just, like, classic. Just reminds me of you going to, like, an old school, you know, concert, choral concert, and just having, you know, like, nothing but vocals. All the sopranos, altos, and the tenors and the basses are there just singing in their little cloaks in the cathedral or wherever, and they're just, you know, doing their thing. They're having a great time. So really, really enjoyed that. And I just wrote "love it" in all caps, because this song was amazing. Because it goes from, like, the chorus, the voice intro, and then it goes into right into, like, a part you can just clap along to live, you know. And I was, like, clapping along to it, had the headphones on. I was like, oh, wow, okay, this is awesome. You know, like, awesome. I loved it. So, "love it," all caps, and there's an exclamation point there, too. And the whole song was just, like, awesome. Like, it gave you that little piratey feeling, and it was just amazing. And then the part where they said, "feel the lightning, feel the thunder," that part, like, the rhythm, I forgot how it went exactly, but the rhythm when they started saying that part, I was like, oh my god, this is amazing. Oh wow, amazing song. Definitely, definitely awesome. This was probably, you know, yeah, this is my favorite track. Just, it just didn't really sound like I thought it would. I thought it'd be, you know, more kind of like, you know, Ship of Doom, doom, gloom, and brr, you know. But it was, like, open with, like, voices, and then had a little clap-along part, and then it was just awesome. Great. Favorite track off the album. All right, now, Kelly? I think I'm pronouncing that right? Track 9? I don't know, my Irish is a little rusty. But I think it's pronounced Kelly, something like that. It's some, it's like a traditional dance in Ireland, and I didn't expect it to be an instrumental track, but it was really, really well placed. I wasn't expecting that at all, you know, and it wasn't, you know, super doomy. It wasn't, you know, like, overly, you know, happy or anything like that either. It just kind of gave you a reprieve from everything, you know, because you've had, like, 8 tracks of so many different, you know, moods and emotions and feels and, you know, stories, and you just have this really nice, you know, instrumental track. So I really enjoyed it. The intro was very, very power metal, which I really enjoyed. That definitely, you know, like, perked up my ears, you know, and got my attention, you know, after you're listening to Ship of Doom, which I actually, you know, repeated. But yeah, so very, very nice. You know, still had that super piratey feel, and I kind of felt like it was an excellent complement to Ship of Doom. Yeah, Ship of Doom, which is you know, piratey, and, you know, had really cool rhythm and stuff, and then, you know, this track came on and had power metal feel to it, and then it kind of went piratey, and then it was just kind of, you know, easy going, you know, nothing, like, too crazy, too nuts. So I felt like it was kind of an excellent complement to Ship of Doom. Like, I felt like, yeah, Ship of Doom and maybe, like, like heli was, you know, kind of happening on the ship, or kind of like a little celebration happening on the ship, you know, below deck and the dance floor, you know, pirates didn't have those and stuff. But very, very nice. And it was the shortest track too, and I saw how short it was. I'm like, oh, this is gonna be interesting. And then it was like the shortest, it's an instrumental, but it was like really, really nice. So yeah, that was a really good track. I really enjoyed that. Short and very, very sweet. Awesome. So 10, Song for Sorrow and Woe. Okay, the lyrics made me think it's sad but true. Like, well, the lyrics and the title of the song kind of made me think it's sad but true. By Metallica. You got Song for Sorrow and Woe, Sad but True. And then just a few of the things, there was a certain part about it where she's talking about, you know, like scapegoating and stuff like that. And I was like, this kind of reminds me of Sad but True a little bit, you know. Not musically, but just like lyrical, like topic-wise. This kind of reminds me of Sad But True. So, you know, good job, you know, emulating Metallica there, if that's what you were going for. And then it gets, like, super dark. It really, dude, it ramps up the intensity, dude. Like, I was surprised, you know. It wasn't, you know, like, too crazy or anything, but then it just gets dark and heavy and... Dude, I pretty much, I actually wrote down, it's like We Are Murderers Part 2, because it just... Out of nowhere, it just gets like, and just like, gets really dark. I looked down. I was like, wow, where did this even come from? You know, because after those like harmonies, it just gets so dark and like evil and heavy and djenty and wow, dude, I was surprised. I was like, wow, this just took like a 180, like, yow. So, but that was actually pretty good, you know, like you can tell, I was legit surprised. That was really good, you know, really good arrangement and everything there, but wow, it just got so dark, you know, Song for Sorrow and Woe, and you know, it's not as dark as you think. It's like, oh yeah, you know, and then just like, boom, boom, doom, doom, death, like, whoa, like, it just got so dark out of nowhere. I was surprised. So yeah, that was pretty much We Are Murderers Part 2, like track 10 called all the way back to track 5 and was like, yo dude, I'm gonna borrow some of this right here, man. And wow, whoa. And then it gets all soft again and like fades out. And like, wow, okay. You're just gonna do that to my emotions right now? But awesome though. Awesome, like, wow, that was quite a track. I mean, all of them were quite tracks, but anyway, so 11, Burn Me. Alright, instruments in the beginning into awesome chorus part. Excellently done. Man, the arrangement was really good for this album. But I'll get to that when I talk about the album as a whole. But Burn Me, like, really awesome. It was kind of happy-ish, you know? At least, you know, music-wise, you know, lyric-wise, it wasn't, you know, super, like, uplifting or positive, but it kind of struck me as, you know, a happy-ish tune. Or the way the music was, you know, written, kind of struck me as kind of gave me a little bit of like a uplifting kind of happy-ish vibe, so that was kind of cool. And of course the rhythm of the guitars and the bass and the drums, they really do that really well in this song. I really enjoyed listening to that. It was a pleasure to my ears. And guest vocals, like, awesome, man. The vocals came out of nowhere, but they were like on point, so really, really enjoyed those a lot. And track 12, Queen of Hearts Reborn. Opening guitar part, awesome. Vocals, awesome. The narration, the speaking, awesome. Awesome. And so, yeah, I don't have too much down, and then Waves. So, when I was listening to this song, I felt, I don't know why, but it just kind of struck me as Waves, you know, kind of like, and you know, not in a bad way, but just, I don't know, it felt very, very, you know, constant and very, what's what I'm looking for, not uniform, but, oh, I don't know what I'm trying to say here, but it just, like, in wave, you know, it just kind of came at you and hit you, but it didn't, like, you know, like, destroy you, it didn't, like, smack you, it was just like, you know, this is really weird, I don't know what I'm saying, but that's how I kind of, I don't really know how to describe what I was thinking at the time, but it just came in like waves, you know, just like, and it just felt very, I don't know. But it was like structured really well. It flowed really well. I guess I'll just say flow. It just flowed really well, you know, like waves in the ocean. Very, very nice. You know, it wasn't, you know, like too insane for me, but it was very, it was structured very well and just flowed very, very well. All right, so Theater Dimensions, tracks like 14 minutes and like 22 seconds. Super long title track. Okay, like, wow, here we go. Okay, chimes, very, very nice. Wasn't sure how this song was gonna start. You know, when you got these long songs, sometimes they start off intense, sometimes they start off soft, sometimes they start with, you know, just keyboards or whatever, but I wasn't sure I was going to start off. The chimes are very, very nice. I enjoyed that. You know, we had a whole 12 tracks of just, you know, relentless, just, like, emotional and, you know, mental and physical, like, assault and, like, so much vivid imagery and storytelling and just, like, wow. Like, you wonder how they're going to top all 12 of these tracks. How is this going to be capped off here? Like, what can they possibly do, you know, after going from Call of Destiny to, like, We Are Murderers, and then, you know, Song for Sorrow and Woe and Burn Me and all that stuff. What are they possibly going to do to cap off this huge beast of an album? And they start off with chimes. Soft, slow, calming chimes. So it has a very somber feel to it, you know, you get like chimes, and it also, it made me think of Christmas times. It was a little Christmassy. I was like, huh, okay, this is interesting. This is a very interesting way to start off a title track to this album, and also the final track of the album. So you got like Christmassy feel, you got chime, it's somber, it's kind of a little ballady, and then it switches like right into adventure mode. It's like, huh, like, you know, it's just amazing. It just goes into this whole another place. And, you know, like I said before, this, all the tracks before this were huge, and they were, like, telling their own stories and everything. But this is, like, when I was listening to this track after it got to the part where the narration first came in, I was like, okay, now it's story time. You know, I was, like, sat in my chair, I was like, okay, now it's story time. You know, I just sat there and listened. I was like, because this is, like, this is the magnum opus right here. This is the big kahuna of this album. And I was like, it's story time right now, son. So, wow, dude, this whole song was just everywhere, dude. You know, as it starts off, you know, like, you know, talking, you know, narration, adventure-y, you know, then you have some guest vocals that come in and, like, do some talking, and it was really, I really like the interplay of the chorus and the guest vocals and, you know, Diane's vocals. Just, it really made for an interesting dynamic. And the music, you know, to me, the vocals did such a great job to where, like, you didn't even really need the music at those points, but the music just enhanced it so well. Because it's kind of like, you know, this dude, like, you know, promising all these things, kind of my Theater Dimensions, and then, like, you turn his own demons get turned on him, and just that whole thing with listening to it was like scary, like it was legit terrifying, because you know you're really, really trapped in this song, and so you're imagining everything that you're hearing, so you're like imagining, you know, this guy's demon getting turned on him, and you can hear him yelling as they devour him and like all this crazy stuff. And it was just everything leading up to that, and just the climax of it, it was just crazy and amazing and terrifying and thought-provoking and, wow, dude, it was just crazy, you know, everything that happened in this song, you know, like the part right before the guy gets the demons, you know, turned on him, there's like this crazy vocal layering thing where it's this guy and then it's more of his vocals and, you know, it's Diane's vocals and they're just like, clawing at your mind with sound. It's just like, oh my god, what's happening? What's going on? Oh my god. Like, you're going crazy because you don't know what is going on here. There's all these voices, like, talking around you and this, like, just cacophony of chaos just everywhere. And you're just like, what is happening here? And then the dude gets the demons turned on him, and then he's, like, screaming and yelling, and then, like, the person who turned the demons on him is, like, laughing like a maniac, and, like, are they evil now? Like, whoa, what's happening here? Like, is the hero the villain now, or, like, what? What is happening? And, wow. Just insane. It was mesmerizing. It was dramatic, and it was huge, and it was just big and massive and terrifying and thought-provoking and, like, scary and so intense. Like, the song started out so soft, and then it just goes into, like, complete and utter chaos and insanity. And I was like, wow, what is happening in this song right now? And then it just goes back to being soft and, you know, happy-ish. And then she's talking to her child and is like, your future will be okay now, child. And then it's just like, it just goes right back to where it started, you know, because it starts off soft and it goes like crazy and crazy and crazy and intense and dark and evil and heavy. And then it just goes right back to where it was, like everything's chill. It's like, okay, your future's okay now, child. I'm just like, what just happened? You know, it was like, wow. Dude, like, all I could say was wow after the song was over. You know, I was just like, wow. Like, you know how Nightwish made Imaginarium into a movie? I want this to be a movie. Like, this needs to be a movie and a book and everything else, because it was amazing. It was just great from top to bottom. You know, it had climaxes, it had rising action, it had falling action. It was awesome. It was amazing to listen to and to imagine and perceive and everything else. Like, this album was amazing. Like, wow. You know, I thought Endless Swarm's Most Beautiful was great. Thought Holographic Principle was great. But wow. This album, they did, like, everything. And then they did more of it. And they did it extremely, extremely well. Wow. The guitars, bass, drums, keyboards, choirs, all the symphonic elements, all the vocals were mixed very, very well. Nothing overpowered anything. Everything was balanced. So many just emotions and ideas and thoughts and moods were just captured so well, you know, in just, you know, one song alone. They could capture two or three moods and feels and emotions, and they put that into every song, and they did it so well. Like, they really, really knew what they were doing, and they did it amazingly well. All the guest vocals were extremely well placed, very proper, very just locked in with everything else. They complemented and contrasted and just added a whole nother dimension to the music. It was amazing. This will definitely be in my top album of the year. It was an amazing spectacle to behold. And wow. Go buy this. Crank it up loud. And wow. I can't wait to go see these guys on tour, man. This is going to be amazing. Excellent, excellent album. Very awesome way to start off, like, well, to start off the year with my first full album review. And in the month of January, like, review-wise, album-wise. Awesome. Awesome, awesome. Thank you all so much for watching this. If you guys like this, give me a like, give me a comment, subscribe. I will have more videos for you guys. Thank you all for watching, and rock on.